Hello, I'm Shelley Quinn. We are so glad you are joining us today for Sabbath School this fourth quarter. The title of our quarterly is Education. And I'll tell you, there's so much. So all who hear the law, it talks about God as deliverer, God as redeemer, God as the one who's going to sanctify us. And the knowledge of his perfect character, the knowledge of his love and his power, people, when they hear this, they're motivated to walk in obedience to God. The quarterly says this: God was intentional about the ways that he imparted his law to Israel. He made every provision so that the laws would not be forgotten. And in this way, God is a long-suffering educator. Think about that for a moment. He teaches, he repeats, he sent his prophets and his servants, then he sent his son to teach us. I want to share this. Often when I go out, I'll tell people, I pray and ask God to discipline me. And you know what happens? There's a collective gasp in the audience. Like, oh no. You see, God is the perfect Father. He is never going to punish you if you need to be loved on. He's never going to love on you. Well, he always loves you, but I mean, he's never going to coddle you if you need to be punished. In Hebrews 12:7, the Bible says you must submit to and endure correction for discipline because God's dealing with you as sons. And you know what? If you are expecting and asking God, Lord, discipline me, you know how he does it? He whispers. At first, he'll say, Shelley, no. Come here, honey. He guides you with his eye upon you till you come to him. But if we don't know the character of God, if we're not listening for that whisper, he has to talk a little bit louder and a little bit louder, and then if we don't obey, we're going to suffer the consequences of our action. So I'll just sum it up by saying this. To know God and his character, we understand the Ten Commandments are his law of love and a parameter that God set to give us a good life.
Amen. Well, thank you. So I've been given Monday's lesson, and when I look at the title, it says, A Witness Against You. Now, I don't know about you folks here, but if I've ever wanted someone to witness for me, I want them to be a witness for me, not against me, right? You know, a witness against you. And so we're going to pick it up from where Shelley left off in Deuteronomy 31. And just to recap Deuteronomy 31, as I was given this lesson, I said, let's go back and look at the context of what's going on in Deuteronomy 31. And of course, we know that Moses was nearing the end of his life, and God had said, you're going to sleep with your fathers very soon. And Joshua is going to come in and pick up where you left off, and he's going to lead you into the promised land. But then God has a little kind of, I want to say a little meeting with Joshua and Moses, and he says, again, Moses, you're not going to lead, you're going to sleep with your fathers. And unfortunately, after you are deceased, the people are going to break the covenant that I've made with them, and they're going to serve other gods. Now, who wants to hear that, right? Wow. You know, I mean, you would think, I don't know what Moses was thinking. He was maybe thinking, wow, it's going to be, you know, continue on. But no. And he goes on and he says, My anger is going to be kindled against them, and I will hide my face from them. And as a result of that, many troubles are going to befall my people. And eventually the people will recognize that these troubles have come upon them because I am not in their midst. And, you know, I don't know if Moses's bubble was burst a little bit at hearing that. But that's what, and I like at the end of verse 21, it says, God is saying, I know their imagination, which they go about, and even now, before I have brought them into the land which I swear. You know, one of the things that I love about God, and there's lots of things to love about God, but one of the things that I love about God is He knows what's going to happen before it ever happens.
Right. Amen.
You know? And you know, that's a testimony to us. Maybe there's someone watching today who's going through some really hard stuff, going through things that they don't understand. God knows. God sees. He knew before it even came to you that you were going to go through this trial, through this experience. Mm-hmm. And He promises to be with you if you want Him to be with you. It reminded me of a passage in Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 and 10, where God says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, My counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure." God knows. He sees. He understands. He knows what's before, long before it ever comes. He knows what you're going to go through. He knew what the children of Israel were going to go through. Now, let's talk about this witness for a moment. As I said before, what is a witness? A witness is someone who can testify, or something that can testify to what has occurred. I don't know if I've never had personally, but I've never had to serve in a court where I've had to be a witness for someone. I can only imagine what that would have been like, or what that experience would be like. But again, you don't want to hear that there is someone being called as a witness against you. You want to hear somebody who's going to testify of your character, what a good person, or you wouldn't have done this thing or whatever. But it says a witness against you. So the lesson says that Moses speaks of the book of the law as though it is a living being with power to reprove the hearts of men.
Amen.
God. Now, I don't know about you, but I have heard this argument many times. Oh, Colossians 2:14 says, you know, the handwriting of ordinances which is against you. My friends, that is not the Ten Commandment law.
That's right. Right?
That's right. Amen.
As Sister Shelley just said, it put it on the side of the Ark of the Covenant that indicate that it would be temporary. And since when has the Ten Commandments ever been used against us, right?
That's right.
Right. No. Well, I'm sure many of our viewers have heard the illustration that, let's say that you're outside working in the garden, and you know, you get dirt on your face or whatever. Now, your eyeballs don't have the ability to see your face, so you don't know that there's dirt on your face until you come in and do what? You go to the washroom, wash up your hands, and you look in the mirror and you say, "Oh man, look at my face, it's filthy." Does the mirror have the ability to clean your face?
No.
Do the Ten Commandments have the ability to correct our sin? Mm-mm. No. But I love what Jesus said. He said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments."
That's right.
The commandments are not a way of salvation. They are, I like to say, proof of salvation.
That's right.
They are an evidence that we belong to God and we follow His way. So now we go to Paul. Paul is talking in Romans chapter 3, in the latter part of the lesson, and they have us read some very familiar passages of Scripture. Romans chapter 3, and beginning with verse 19, I'm reading from the Standard King James this morning, or today, and it says, "Now we know that what things soever the law says, it saith to them that are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be what?
Justified,
right? In His sight. For by the law is what?
The knowledge
of sin. The law doesn't necessarily correct our sin. It doesn't help us to become better, but it shows us what our character flaws are.
That's right.
And then down at the end, at verse 23, he says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God."
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I think about that, don't get too down on yourself whenever you find that you messed up, or whenever you find that you make a mistake. For Paul says, all have sinned. But you know what? There's grace found in Jesus.
Amen.
There's grace found in the blood of the Lamb. And even back in verse 10 of chapter 3 there, it says, "There is none righteous." Mm. No, not one.
That's right.
Not one. But in Jesus, there is victory. And so when we talk about a witness against us, I like that they wrap up on Monday's lesson by saying, even as we seek to obey God's law with all our God-given strength, in what ways does His law function as a witness against us? Mm. Unfortunately, the old covenant, the old covenant served as that witness against you. Remember, as Shelley pointed out, the first time that God came to them and they said, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do, right? And did they? No. Over and over and over. God had to correct them. God had to guide them and sometimes even discipline them. But whenever we talk about that witness against us, yes, that old covenant. I'm so glad we don't have to live by that old covenant.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Imagine if every time that one of us messed up that we had to go and get a precious lamb and take it to the priest and offer it as a sacrifice. Oh, how painful that would be. Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm so glad that we don't have to live. Because why? Jesus has fulfilled all of that.
Amen.
Jesus has provided He's the true lamb, the true substitution, and we don't have to worry anymore. Mm-hmm. But guess what? In the blood of Christ, there is victory, and there is power to overcome. There is power. Mm-hmm. What is it? There's power in the blood of the Lamb, right?
That's right.
You know, there's power, wonder-working power. God offers that power to us. So don't get tripped up by thinking that, oh, the Ten Commandments are not important anymore. Oh, they're done away with, a nail to the cross. That's not what Paul was saying in Colossians. Mm-hmm. He's saying that book of the law that really was a witness against you, you don't have to abide by that any longer.
Amen. Shelley? Thank you so much. This is Terry's first time with us. You did a marvelous job.
Amen.
You know, we got to remember that the Ten Commandments are actually 10 promises of what God will empower us to do. It is His law of love that reflects His character. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're going to have a quick break. We'll be right back.
Ever wish you could watch a 3ABN Sabbath School panel again? Or share it on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter? Well, you can by visiting 3abnsabbathschoolpanel.com. A clean design makes it easy to find the program you're looking for. There are also links to the Adult Bible Study Guide so you can follow along. Sharing is easy. Just click share and choose your favorite social media. Share a link. Save a life for eternity.
Now Danny is going to take Tuesday's lesson that you may prosper.
Well, I've been blessed so far. I don't know about you all, but it's really wonderful to study about the law of God. The text is Joshua 1:7-8, if you all want to read it with me. It says, only be strong and very courageous that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or the left. Keep that in mind. We'll talk about it later. That you may do what? Prosper wherever you go.
That's right.
This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night. Wow. You shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to a little bit that's written.
No.
All, right? That you may do all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Now, how many of us don't want to be prosperous and succeed in whatever we're doing, right? So there you have it. The key to prosperity and success is to meditate on the law of God day and night, and then to do it. It's do is an action word, I would say. Do according to what is written in that law. So first of all, God wants His people to prosper and be successful. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
In fact, He wants us to prosper, be in good health, it says. I threw in Jeremiah 29:11 that I'm sure you all know. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future.
Amen.
That's the loving God that you all were talking about, Terry, you were just talking about, that's on our side. He's the witness for us, not against us. So if we are to reflect God's character in our lives, then I think it's safe to say we need to be happy and healthy and prosperous, right? Mm-hmm. And we succeed in whatever we're doing. But so here's the key, though. The key word would be, how do we define success and prosperity?
That's good.
Because to everybody, it's going to mean something differently. So we can read this scripture and say, some business person can say, wow, I'm fulfilling, you know, the scriptures because I'm very successful in my business. Somebody else says, well, hey, I'm very prosperous in what I do. But let's see what, let's try to define it a little bit, work into it. The key here again, how do we define success and prosperity? The secular world defines it, success as money, mm-hmm. power, and influence, right? Mm-hmm. In general, there's other things, but in general. But it's not like the secular world versus the church mm-hmm. or Christians, because honestly, within Christianity, there is counterfeit prosperity. Right. Which brings me that if you ever watch radio and television, there's a whole lot of televangelists mm-hmm. that preaches what's called a prosperity gospel.
That's right.
Yeah. Now, let's talk about that prosperity gospel for just a little bit. What it really, and I'll just do it in a nutshell. I made a lot of notes. I won't go through all of that. But in a nutshell, it says, listen, if you want God to bless you, then whatever you send to me, that's the televangelist talking, God will bless it 100-fold. So if you've got, one man said, if you got an old Cadillac, you know, or got a, he said, he changed it. He didn't want an old Cadillac, but if you got a good Cadillac and you donate it to me, God will give you a brand new one. That's called prosperity. So if you give to that prosperity preacher, according to them, prosperity and success, God is going to measure that out to you. But I found out, my experiences told me, and when you get my age, you start getting a little experience, if nothing else, is that usually the only ones becoming healthy and wealthy are the prosperity teachers, because it doesn't always work that way. Now, does God bless your giving and the support of His work? Absolutely. Will He multiply when you're giving to His cause? Absolutely. Can you prosper? Absolutely, you can. But I want to say here, so what is the scripture talking about when it says right here, that we will prosper and we'll be successful? Now, could it mean that we will be prosperous in business mm-hmm. and that we will be successful mm-hmm. in our business? Okay. Of course, that is one of the definitions it could be. I think a lot of these prosperity preachers should be teaching the truth. And that truth is that our knowledge, we prosper spiritually by keeping and obeying the commandments of God. Mm-hmm. Most of those, many of those, already, as you guys mentioned, have said, well, they're nailed to the cross. Would you say Colossians? You yeah. brought up Colossians. They're nailed to the cross. No, the Ten Commandments were not nailed to the cross. Mm-hmm. So success means a number of things, but prosperity and success does not always fit the description I wrote down of how the world judges prosperity and success. What? Let's look at it like this. What prosperous, wealthy person who is really old and sick wouldn't trade, right, his treasure, his prosperous life, right, and successful yeah. business for youth and health, yeah. right? Because when we get down to the end, we find out that what the world judges as prosperous and successful does not line up to the Bible.
Right.
So while we as Christians can enjoy good health and prosper in business, I believe the bigger picture of prosperity and success comes from knowing and obeying the law of God. Why is that? Because in the law of God, we find eternal life. Only then can we trust God with our lives and with our talents and abilities that He's given us. So prospering in your Christian walk with the Lord and prospering in your ministry, fulfilling the great gospel commission of go ye into all the world, for me, it says, in the preparing our family and ourselves for heaven is the greatest success we can attain. Mm-hmm. Getting our lives and those around us witnessing for Jesus, mm-hmm. that to me is true prosperity and true success. So to set the record straight again, prosperity and success is not measured by how much money we have, how much power, and how much influence we have. It's measured by eternal life. Did we answer the call of God on our lives and be a witness for Him, submit and commit our lives to Jesus? Or do we turn away, as the world says, to do our own thing and decide to live our own life? Joshua here tells us that if we keep focused on the law of God, we meditate on it day and night, and that we obey it, we will prosper and we'll succeed. Now, to me, 3ABN, and of course I may be a little prejudiced, but 3ABN is a great example of a success mm-hmm. after 35 years of ministry, yeah. starting with nothing and now able to reach the world. Okay, so the question may be asked, what is the secret to 3ABN success? First, I'll tell you what it's not, okay? What it's not because of any of the leadership or any of the messengers. Because none of us are perfect. I hate to tell you all this, but none of us, we're all imperfect.
That's right.
And so are you at home, don't be laughing. So you are too, we're all imperfect. The correct answer, in my opinion, is this. God gave 3ABN the commission of taking an undiluted three angels' messages, one that would counteract the counterfeit into all the world. And for 35 years, that's exactly what we've been preaching.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are many who started out, whether it be George Vandeman, Joe Cruz, even Kenneth Cox, many of those are asleep in Jesus.
Mm.
Many haven't been preaching this message for years, but the new Ryan Days and the Terry Sheltons and all the young ones you see are preaching the same message. They didn't deviate. 3ABN has not gone to the left. We've not gone to the right. So what's important is not the messenger, it's the message.
That's right.
Yeah,
so if we will stick, as this scripture said, to the law of God, we'll meditate on it day and night, that we don't go to the right, we don't go to the left, mm-hmm. and we say, Lord, I'm putting my life into your hands. So to me, the success is 3ABN. You think about a ministry that for so many years, year after year after year, and all the millions of dollars it takes without doing begathons and prosperity gospel, somehow all the bills are paid when it comes to the end.
Praise
I mean, to me, that is absolutely amazing. So I'm running out, I'm looking at that clock, and now it's being witnessing against me, Terry. So all I want to say to you is the God's Word equips us to overcome sin by the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
And so today, realize we're in there's a war raging. You and I are in this battle between good and evil, the great controversy between good and evil. And so the devil is out to get us, to deceive us, but we can always trust in the Lord. So Terry said it beautifully, but all we have to do is commit our lives to Jesus and say, Lord, create within me a new heart.
That's right.
I'm a sinner, and if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us from our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What a wonderful God we serve. And I hope today that each and every one of you, if you've not already made your choice for Jesus, that you do it today.
Mm. Amen.
Praise the Lord, man. You made my job easier as far as mine, because I believe it's Wednesday's lesson, The Toils and Struggles of Law Keepers, there's also an aspect of talking about prosperity in connection with law keeping. And, you know, that happens to be one of the questions that comes up often, and that is the what ifs and the whys of you know, there's this promise in the, for instance, you gave, I think you gave Joshua as an example. The lesson brings out that Joshua closely followed God's precepts and he led the people of Israel well. And of course, time and time again, the Lord tells Israel that if they obey the law, that they would prosper.
Mm-hmm.
And so you see this promise there, but then, you know, within the home, we're talking about education, right? We're talking about, you know, let's get into the family now and the home within the family. Sometimes those tough questions come up. You know, those teenagers come to mom and dad and they say, hey, you know, I've been trying to keep the law. Okay, I'll come back to that. Trying to keep the law, and you know, God said that we would prosper and all this, but I'm not prospering. What's going on?
Mm.
And there's multiple examples also in Scripture where a lot of people they twist and use the Word of God against themselves as a witness against themselves. How you can do that, I don't know. But people sometimes take the Word of God and they'll twist it to their own destruction and allow certain aspects of Scriptures to discourage them because they believe it's contradicting one aspect or the other. The lesson brings out and gives a few examples. John the Baptist is probably a prime example, at least one example. I mean, the Bible says that John the Baptist, Jesus called him the greatest of all prophets,
yes.
Right? I mean, this man was full of the Holy Spirit from the womb, and he came out preaching and declaring the way of the Lord to make straight the path for Jesus to come on the scene. And this brother ends up in jail, and of course, a harlot convinces the king to give me his head on a platter, and you're thinking, no, this is God's man, right? He keeps the commandments of God. He's obedient. He does all that the Lord has said. He's the greatest of all the prophets. Surely the Lord will protect him. He will be prosperous throughout all of his days upon this earth. And then, you know, you can imagine, you know, inside that jail cell, John the Baptist is praying and saying, you know, Lord, I know you're going to bring me through. Hey, he even sent out his guys to Jesus, right? Sent them to Jesus, confirm just to make sure he's the right guy. Oh, yeah, I knew it. Jesus is going to show up. Any moment, Jesus is going to bust me out of jail. And then came the day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what did he get from God?
Yeah.
Silence.
Mm.
You know, that's a tough deal. Another example would be Job, right? The Bible says that Job was a perfect man in the eyes of the Lord. He was an obedient person. He kept all of God's commandments. But yet we see the story of Job there. In fact, there's a clear implied accusation in that heavenly counseled meeting that Satan shows up to. It's so sad to see that Satan is there, and he basically accuses God and basically says, oh, no, the only reason why he's serving you is because you're causing him to be prosperous. Mm. And you got a hedge of protection around him. You lift that hedge of protection, you take away all of his goodies, and watch him curse you to your face. Mm. In other words, what Satan was implying is, God, you in and of yourself are not worthy to be worshiped.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
And so a lot of people, they read these stories and they get discouraged. Think of Paul. I'm listening to this. 2 Corinthians 11, 23 through 29. You read this list and you think, man, this is the direct opposite of prosperity, right? I mean, Paul was, you know, he wasn't a perfect man. He made mistakes, obviously. But from the moment that God called him, this brother was growing and growing and growing in God's grace. He was an obedient serviceman of the Lord. But listen to this list here. Starting with verse 23, 2 Corinthians chapter 11. It says, Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. No, notice what he says. He says, I am more in labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequently, in deaths often. From the Jews, 5 times I received 40 stripes minus 1. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils of the city, in perils of the wilderness, in perils of the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil, in sleepless often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides all these other things, what comes upon me daily? My deep concern for all the churches. So it's interesting. You read that list there and it's like, man, God, you gave a promise. Did this brother prosper? And I think it goes back to what Danny was saying, which I love the way you brought that out. We got to question and ask ourselves, what is prosperity? When the Bible says that you shall prosper if you are obedient to God and you are faithful to the Lord, that doesn't mean that you're going to have 2 Ferraris and $10 million in the bank. But yet that's exactly as Brother Danny brought out, and I try not to get too deep into this because I get a little heated sometimes when I get into this conversation, but all of these prosperity evangelists, these televangelists that are out there preaching and teaching, you know, sow this seed and sow that seed, and as you brought out very clearly, you know, deceiving people into believing that the gospel is about how much money you give so that you can get even more in return.
Yeah.
And we know that there are instances, you know, I've even been on the receiving end of a blessing.
Absolutely.
A prosperous financial blessing because
Absolutely.
I was able to share or give to God's cause, but that nowhere in God's word does God say, hey, give me money and I'll give you more money.
That's
you know,
right.
you know, serve me and be obedient to me and I'll just flood you with all kinds of money and all kinds of
right.
financial blessing. That's not what we're talking about when it says prosperity. The ultimate prosperity that we want is a spiritual prosperity.
Amen.
Right.
We want to be prosperous in faith, hope, and love in Jesus Christ. That's what the gospel is about. I think of probably the greatest example of all of someone who really, you could probably say, probably lost more than anyone, who was less prosperous than anyone, was Jesus.
Mm.
Absolutely.
I mean, Jesus was, there's no one else in the history of man that was perfect, literally.
Mm-hmm.
He never sinned. He kept God's commandments 24/7 throughout his entire life. And at the end of his days, hanging on a cross, what kind of response did he get from his Father? Silence.
Yeah. Mm.
Silence.
That's deep.
Does that mean that, you know, do we look at those instances and we question and say, oh, God didn't keep his promise? No. We have to, as C.S. Lewis would say, sometimes we have to, we must address the assumptions in a question before we answer the question. And a lot of people naturally assume that prosperity means, as we've described, you know, lots of financial blessing, lots of worldly success. But God, well, he does want us to be financially prosperous in the sense that our needs are met and that we are, you know, not necessarily, you know, wanting in every single aspect of life. But more than anything, Jesus died on the cross so that we can be rich in him and rich in spirituality, rich in Jesus Christ and in the Holy Spirit. So, you know, David says in Psalm 84, verse 10, I love this. He says, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wickedness. Mm-hmm. Woo! That's a powerful thing. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. And that should be our saying as well. That should be where our heart is. Man, I'm watching that clock. Pray for that clock. I'm with you, Danny, on that. So what is the answer? How do we answer this? First of all, you know, when we see brothers and sisters, you know, that seem to be like the Pauls and the John the Baptists and the Jobs, and you know, many of us have to, we see each other struggle, we see others struggle, and it's like, man, that brother and sister, that's a commandment keeping person. That's the remnant, but they're struggling. How do we answer that? Again, it kind of goes back to the question that people often ask: why do bad things happen to good people, right? And I think Pastor Loma Cain set me straight one day on that. He said, yeah, well, that goes back to that C.S. Lewis thing. He said, you're assuming that everyone's good, that there's good people. Remember, there's none good but one, and that's Jesus Christ. But that being said, my friends, I think there are examples in Scripture that we can give. First of all, we have to be reminded that in Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9, he says to us, look, my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts. God knows what's best for you and for me. And sometimes, God will allow us to experience things or go through certain trials and tribulations in our life, even as commandment keepers, because He's wanting to build character. A scripture that comes to mind is James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Mm. I love this text. He says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. How many of us fall into these various trials and tribulations and throw our hands in there and say, praise God for all these horrible things that are happening to me? We don't do that often, right? Because in our carnal human nature, all we can see sometimes in the moment is, man, why is this happening to me? Yeah. But a true spiritual person is going to realize that, as the Bible says, when we fall into these various trials, we praise God for that. We count it a joy because we know that our faith is being tested, and it produces patience, the Bible says. Mm-hmm. But let patience, as James says in verse 4, again, this is James 1, verse 4, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So let me set the record straight here. If you're someone at home that's been questioning the Word of God, questioning, I've been trying to be good, but it doesn't seem like anything's good. Good is happening to me. My friends, let me tell you something. God is not causing those bad things to happen to you. Jesus clarified it in Matthew 13 in the parable of the wheat and the tares. He made it very, very, very clear. He said, an enemy has done this. You go read it, Matthew 13, verse 28. An enemy has done this. Don't point the finger at God, just like Job was probably tempted to. But Job never gave up on the Lord. The Lord came through for him and ended up blessing him much more abundantly in the end. So even though we go through these toils and these tribulations and these trials in our life, look to Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith.
Amen. Thank you so much, Ryan. What an incredible study. If you're going through anything, if you're discouraged, that's the lesson for you. Mm-hmm. Powerful. Thank you for that. The law as teacher. We looked at the importance of hearing the law, loving and fearing the law, obeying the law. How the law leads to prosperity, especially spiritual prosperity. Right. Mm-hmm. I love that. Thursday's lesson is Jesus, our example of obedience. Jesus, our example. He was, of course, the perfect Lamb of God. John said what? Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. He was our perfect substitute, our perfect Savior, but He was also our perfect example. Mm-hmm. That's what we look at today. Jesus is our example in obedience. Mm-hmm. I want to start with a poem I really like. This is by Edgar Guest. Sermons We See. You've probably heard this. We'll just quote a couple of stanzas. I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. Mm-hmm. I'd rather one should walk with me than merely show the way. The eye's a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Fine counsel is confusing. But example, it's always clear. Mm-hmm. And the best of all the preachers are the men who live their creeds. For to see good put in action is what everybody needs. I soon can learn to do it if you let me see it done. I can watch your hands in action, though your tongue too fast may run. Mm-hmm. And the lecture you may deliver may be very wise and true. But I'd rather get my lesson by observing what you do.
Amen.
For I might misunderstand you in the high advice you give, but there's no misunderstanding how you act and how you live. One good man teaches many. Men believe what they behold. One deed of kindness noticed is worth 40 that are told. Mm. who stands with men of honor learns to hold this honor dear. For right living speaks a language which to everyone is clear. Though an able speaker charms me with his eloquence, I say, I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. Amen. And that's what the that's nice. Lord Jesus Christ did when he came to this earth as a baby, grew up as a man, and lived that perfect life of example for you and I. Because we can look at the law and say, wow, mm-hmm. Pastor Ryan, that's pretty serious. Right. That's holy. The law is holy, just, and good. But when we saw Jesus live that law out in action as our perfect example of obedience. You know, there was a leader once who said, do what I say, not what I do. But that is not what the Lord Jesus said. He set an example for us to follow. So I want to look at four things that Jesus chose as it pertains to obedience. Number one, Jesus chose to obey his parents. Mm-hmm. Let's look at Luke chapter 2. Turn with me to Luke chapter 2, verses 51 and 52. Now, before we read this, we know that Jesus was in the temple with the doctors of the law, the rabbis, the scribes, the Pharisees, for days. Remember, he was listening, he was asking questions and answering their questions. Right. And of course, Mary and Joseph lost Jesus. We heard this on a previous lesson for 3 whole days. Mm. Then it says, right after that, they said, where have you been, Jesus? They found him. They said, where have you been? And what did he say? King James said, wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business? You see there, Jesus is 12 years old in the temple, understanding who he is, that he is the Lamb of God, that these lambs that are being sacrificed, that he came to be that sacrifice, understanding that he came from God and he was to be that sacrifice. Then it says right after that in verse 51, then he, that's Jesus, went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject to them. But his mother kept all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. Mm-hmm. That word for subject in Greek means to submit or place yourself under. It's the same word Paul uses when he says, wives, submit to your husbands, or slaves, submit to your master. So Jesus was subject or submitted to the authority of his parents. Now, that is really pivotal to me, because just before then, he realized who he was, that he is the Son of God, yet he submitted himself to his parents in obedience. Jesus chose to obey his parents. Number two, Jesus chose obedience over any physical or emotional discomfort. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Often, if I'm faced with ridicule or pain or something that seems humiliating or a little disgraceful, I might be tempted to fudge or not be so obedient. But yet Jesus chose obedience over anything else. Turn with me to Philippians 2. I like this, the mind of Christ. Philippians 2, verses 5 through 8. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking on him the form of a servant, and coming in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient, that's our word, obedient, right, to the point of death, even the death of the cross. I see 5 levels of digression here. He is the Son of God, divine. He could have just stooped to the level of angels, could have stooped to the level of humanity. Then he stooped to the level of sinful humanity, because he took our flesh after the fall, our sinful nature. Right. He stooped to the point of death, and not just any death, but death on the cross, which was the most humiliating and degrading death that they had. When you think, I can't, remember that Jesus did. He endured hunger and privation, humiliation, pain, torture, and death. He chose obedience over any physical or emotional discomfort. Mm-hmm. Number three, he chose to always honor and obey his father. John chapter 8, verses 28 and 29, John 8, 28 and 29. Jesus said to them, "When you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father has taught me." It was not through any of His own strength that He walked in obedience. It was that connection, dependence on and connection with His Father. "It's because I depend on my Father that I do these things." Verse 29, "And He who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do what? Those things that please Him." Mm-hmm. Jesus always chose, if there was a decision, you could say a fork in the road, something that you're looking at, He always chose, "I'm going to honor my Father."
Amen.
"I'm going to obey my Father. I'm going to do what my Father wants as opposed to maybe what I want myself." Finally, number four, Jesus chose to allow suffering to perfect Him. Hebrews 5, verse 8. "Though He was a son, yet He learned obedience through the things which He suffered." Have you ever noticed that trials drive us to God, or they might drive you away from God when you go through a difficult experience? I remember someone who works here at 3BM, I'll call him Sam, that's not his real name. He broke his hip, went in the hospital. Greg and I went to go visit him. We went to encourage him because he's going through a hard time. He just is having surgery. He's in pain. He encouraged us. And I came back to 3ABN and I shared with someone, "I can't believe we went to see Sam and he encouraged us." And the person said, "Oh, that's Sam. He's always like that. He's just a cheerful person." No, he chose to allow suffering to perfect his character, and that trial he turned to God instead of away from God. You know, trials patiently endured, they produce righteousness in the life of the believer. Hebrews 12, verse 11, "Now no chastening or no trial for the present, it's not joyful, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness."
Amen.
To those who are trained by it.
Amen.
Trials produce righteousness. Trials produce character in the life of the believer. Romans 5, verses 3 and 4. "We glory in tribulation." Now in the Greek, there's two words for this pressure. There's an internal and an external tribulation. This is the internal pressure, phlipsis. We glory when we go through internal tribulation, when we go through trials. Why? Because it produces perseverance, and perseverance produces character, and character produces hope. Trials produce patience and maturity in the life of the believer. Last scripture, 1 John 2, 6. "He who says he abides in Him ought himself also to walk even as he walked." You and I are called to follow the example of the Lord Jesus Christ and do that walk of obedience, perfect submission, perfect dependence on our Father in heaven.
Well, amen. Praise the Lord. Each and every one. Before we have a closing comment, it just occurred to me I'd like to explain this to our audience at home. When you are reading the Bible, when you see the word law, you have to look in context to know what it's talking about. If it says the law and the prophets, it's talking about the whole Old Testament. If it says the book of Moses, it's the, or the book of the law, it's talk, excuse me. If it says the law of Moses, it's talking about the first five books. If it says the book of the law, it's talking about Deuteronomy. And then sometimes law is used to mean the Ten Commandments, because that is God's law of love. The book of Galatians, people have said to me, as Galatians 3, 24 says that the law was our tutor, but now it was to bring us to Christ, but now that it has come, He has come, we no longer need a tutor. They'll say, see, that's the law. But right there in the context, we know He's talking about the book of the law because just a few scriptures earlier, He's talking about the book of Deuteronomy. That's what Galatians is about. Colossians 2:14, you mentioned, says, "Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, He took it and nailed it to the cross." Well, we're looking here, Deuteronomy 31:26. There were curses in the book of the law. These were on the outside of the ark as a witness against the people. If you read the context, you'll understand. We'll go around for a quick comment.
Very quick.
I just want to say, friends, don't let anybody tell you that the Ten Commandments have been done away with or
That's
nailed
right.
to the cross. 1 John chapter 2, verses 3, 4, and 5. And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Yeah. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected.
Amen.
Hereby we know that we are in him.
We're talking about Christian education and the lesson set as part of Christian education. We need to keep God's law as a central component of what it means to live by faith and trusting in God's grace.
Amen. Mm,
amen. We do not keep the commandments of God to be prosperous, my friends. We keep the commandments of God because we love him. John 14:15, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Amen.
Christ is our perfect example, and I love John 15, the vine attached, where the branches attached to the vine. We receive our sustenance and nourishment from the Lord Jesus.
Amen. Thank you all so much. And I just remember this, that the new covenant, God says in Hebrews 8:8-10, I'm going to write my law in your heart. Hallelujah. And obedience is not legalism. Obedience is love.
That's right.
It's just an expression of our love and loyalty to God. These Ten Commandments are 10 promises of what He will do in each and every one of our lives. And love is the fulfillment of God's law. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye. Thank you.
anyone who's watching us this morning, be it their TV or Zoom or YouTube, wherever you are, I hope you have a blessed Sabbath today. But I also want everyone not to forget something. The church isn't dead. We're very much alive. And ministry is going on, and the Lord is blessing. The other evening, we were on a prayer meeting, and an individual came on. You know, we're on Zoom for prayer meeting on Wednesday night, and we had a new person join us. And, Amen. You know, we know the Lord is sending people. And, you know, even in this time when we're doing things quite differently, and he's blessing. And if you haven't been on Friday night, Saturday night, and Sunday night at 7 o'clock, you also are missing a blessing. Some of the questions that are coming from individuals, you can tell that the people are out there thirsting for answers. And the Lord has given us that second opportunity to do that. And, you know, we praise God for that. It's not our doing, it is definitely his doing. But in order for us to do everything that we're doing, I don't want you to forget about the church. You know, finances is important. These programs cost. And even though, you know, we're so used to picking up our phone and talking to our family and we don't think anything of it, this is definitely something totally different. So there are several ways that you can support the church. We are online for the online people. We do have that opportunity. If you go to our website, you can drop down a box and it'll tell you how to do it. You can mail the tithe in. And if you're with me in here with us, I take your money and put it in the bank. And I promise I put it in the bank. Yeah. And so, you know, it's the blessing of the Lord.
Amen.
And that's where we're here this Sabbath. I do have a little church business. The first reading of Leah Crosby. If you have watched the program, she is the young lady on the program with Pastor and Pastor Brooks. And she is transferring. She has started. Let me come back a step. They have started a church in Media, PA, not far from us. And that church has been going on under her leadership as a Bible worker. And so the conference, now that she's baptizing, praise the Lord, Amen. She's had a few baptisms. And it Amen. Sounds like there's also a few waiting in the wings to be baptized. The conference has asked her to transfer her membership from us to the Pennsylvania Conference Church. That's what it's called, until they're able to form, you know, a church of their own. So that's our first reading of transferring Leah to the Pennsylvania Conference Church, and then next week we'll do the actual vote on her. Yeah. So for all of you out there, I just want to praise God today. This is his Sabbath that he blessed, and welcome everyone here.
Amen. Amen. Please stand as we sing our call to worship.
Empty that pain. together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sins upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sins upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sins upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Amen. Please bow your heads. Our gracious Father in heaven, we are honored to be here this morning. We are here to worship you, to sing praises, to pray, to study your word because of how great and how mighty you are. We thank you for waking us up. We thank you for your breath in our lungs, for seeing us through another week. Even though some of us have gone through challenges, we're still here because of you, and we thank you and give you the praise for that. May our worship this morning be acceptable in that, in your sight. And we ask for you to send your Holy Spirit to be amongst us. May we leave at the end of service changed. We ask all this in the name of your loving Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. Thank you so much for that wonderful welcome and good response, Steve. Appreciate it so much. Amen. I just want to say a couple of words in terms of, we call this a ministry minute, but those of you who understand education, which is very, very important in today's environment especially, we need to have as much knowledge as possible, but their own knowledge should not be limited simply to knowledge about what's happening on earth. We need to know about heavenly things, amen? And this quarter, our Sabbath school class, our study, is about education. And I want to encourage everyone. I know this, sometimes we have difficulty in accessing the hard copy, but these are very accessible now online. So try to access our Sabbath school lesson online. I'm promoting it for a special reason, because we live in an age where we really need to educate our children, especially our the new generation. There are too many things going on out there to distract them in negative ways. So we want to make sure that we as parents, and if you don't even have a child, you could speak to other children. You still have, we are family. Try as much as you possibly can to study the Word of God. More than anything else, we need to do that. We just began today, we launched today our Sabbath school class here in the fellowship hall for the first time. We have a pilot program which quite well. So if any of you would like to join us going forward next Sabbath at 10 o'clock, we will be here for Sabbath school. We have practicing, so we're still practicing social distancing. We have separated and have these chairs sitting apart. But if you would like to join us live, you can do that. And if you want to still join us via Zoom, you can also do that. We want to just reassure you, because there are many people who like to come together in person to study. So just want to let you know that is something that we started today. We're going to continue to promote it. And as long as we social distance, if you feel comfortable, you're welcome to join us as we study the Word of God. And I just also want to, again, before she comes up, is to thank our speaker, Denise, for her wonderful sermons that she's been providing us. She will be speaking today and also next Sabbath. Please invite your friends and family to come out and let's fellowship, let's worship together. We've been doing it in a very safe way. We'd like for you to continue to do that. And for those online, don't be afraid anymore. You could come out if you feel comfortable and fellowship and worship with us as well. Sister Joanne already mentioned about our finances, and I just want to again underscore what she said earlier in terms of the need that we have in terms of supporting our programs here. Don't forget, tithe is important, but also financial support for the programs and our ministries here. So continue to be faithful, and God will certainly bless us. So thank you again for those online. If you are listening, watching, continue to support us financially online. And if you do have a problem donating online, you can reach out to me and I'll give you some guidance as how your offerings can be delivered to our church. God bless you as we continue to worship.
Our next song is Lord, I Need You. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, I am free. Holiness is Christ in Amen. Our call to prayer this morning is hymn number 73, Holy, Holy, Holy. Please meditate upon the words as we prepare for prayer. The ability, please join me in kneeling as we seek the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you so much for your mercies and for your goodness. Thank you for your Son who paid it all for us. Thank you for allowing us to be here to worship you this morning. Thank you for seeing us through this week. Thank you for just how wonderful you are, for who you are, for creating us, for your blessings upon us. We come to you this morning. We have struggles. We have doubt. We think we are in control. And I just ask this morning that you please forgive us. Please forgive us for where we fall short. For when we doubt, for when we think we are in control. You're the one that's in control. You're the one that all praise should be given unto you. Please, I ask that you just be with each one that's here. Please be with all those that are watching online as well. Touch each heart. Send your Holy Spirit to comfort and impress upon each one. Please be with our church as far as the ongoing evangelistic series are taking place. Three churches that are involved, Fairview, Bucks, the church plant, and Media. I ask for your blessing, please. Send your Holy Spirit just to be with all those watching. Those that have questions, may their questions be answered. Be with Pastor Brooks. Be with Pastor Joshua. Be with Leah as they present. That it's your words that will flow out and affect hearts and change hearts and bring them unto you. Please be with those that are ailing within our church family. I ask that you just please be with Susan as she recovers from her procedure. Please also be with Rich as he recovers from his procedure. There are many others. There are silent requests here as well. Touch each heart. May each one know that you are close to them. We are living in tough times. COVID is raging rampant. But you are in control, and we know that with you we have nothing to fear. And we ask for your protection upon all, please. Be with our youth as well, that they may have that relationship and closeness upon you. I ask that you also please be with our speaker this morning, Sister Denise. May it be your words that uplift each one of us. And may we leave here different to go out and do your service. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and thank you for your many blessings. We ask all this not because we are worthy, but because of your Son and because you love us so much. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Amen.
God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew 12, 38 to 41. And it says, "Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered, saying, 'Teacher, we want to see a sign from you.' But he answered and said unto them, 'An evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and indeed a greater than Jonah is here.' May the Lord add his blessing to his word."
Morning. Are we on? All right. Good to see all of you. I think there's a few more of us than were here last week, so we're getting used to the rhythms and nuances of the world we now live in. So for the sake of God's word and all that he wants to accomplish over the next few minutes, let's bow our heads one more time and pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we come before you now to open your word, your sacred word. We're told in the New Testament that the words that are written here are especially for those upon whom the ends of the world have come. And so for most of us, the world that we knew is gone. We pray that the word today might be powerful for us. Certainly not because of the speaker, but because of the Spirit. We ask in Jesus' name, Amen. All right, I was just talking with one of my brothers in the hallway, my brother and sister, about our mutual love of museums. Anybody else a fan of museums? I'm a big fan of museums. And so if you go to the Smithsonian, you can see this very important piece of work. Anybody know what it is? We at least know that it's a what?
Bible.
It's a book, and yes, it is a Bible. So here's the story. The story is that an aging president, his name was Thomas Jefferson, sat with the New Testament and a razor blade. Anybody know the rest of this story? And he redacted his New Testament over a period of time. And he cut and pasted in the way that it was done when it was really cut and paste. And he put it all back together into a book of morals and philosophy and put Jesus' name on it. And so what is it that you think that he took out? Everybody's going, I don't know, Denise, tell us what he took out. He took out everything that was supernatural. So you know enough about Thomas Jefferson to know why that might be true. Thomas Jefferson was a man, he would have called himself a man of the Enlightenment. He would have called himself a man of reason. And so he just took out everything that didn't leave God as a God of enlightenment and reason. And so some of you are scandalized, of course. But it's interesting. I just want to ask you as a prequel to what we're going to talk about today. Would you say that your own culture is one that is a little shy of the supernatural, the transcendent, where God is concerned? Because unfortunately, there's a lot of supernatural things going on. You can tell if you drive out of this church and take a right and take one of your first lefts. There's a little corner office there. You can find all the supernatural you want if you walk through that door, but not where God is concerned. And so Jonah, which is where we are, for those of you that are here for the first time, for those of you that are watching for the first time, we have been studying the book of Jonah, and today we're going to conclude. And there is a little bit of confrontation with regard to something much bigger, pun intended, than ourselves. Now let me ask you a question. Is it necessary for you, or is it profitable, I should say, is it profitable for you to cut and paste out of your Bible those things which seem just a little bit impossible? Should you do that? Will it serve you well? It will not. And we're going to see finally why that's very, very true today. So as we delve back into the book of Jonah, and what's our title today? Bigger Fish to Fry. So let's back up from the bigger fish and let's look at this fish right here. You know, this is like a low-grade supernatural story, wouldn't you say? You remember the context of this story? All right, it involves two men. Who are they? Jesus himself and Peter, all right? And actually, it involves more than two men because somebody came to visit Peter. Who was it? The IRS came to visit Peter. And they said, hey, hand it over your taxes. And so Peter was miffed, and he was like, no. And so there's a lot more going on in the story. We're just going to focus on the fact that at the end of the story, Jesus gives Peter an admonition. He says, go down to the pier, toss in your line, not your net, your line. Now, if he tossed in a net, there might have been a number of different fish that could have provided, but he said, toss in your line, and the first fish that you pull out, what's going to happen? There's going to be a coin in his mouth, a shekel actually, the half shekel tax, one for Peter and one for Jesus. Has anybody ever wrestled with the necessity of believing that this story is true? Do you believe this story is true? True. All right, so what I want to remind you is just a bigger fish. just a bigger cargo. That's it. In terms of whether or not you have any trouble taking the story out of the children's book, off of the nursery wallpaper, and I'm going to join with you today in reminding myself that believing in things that are bigger than we are is necessary if you really want to be intelligent. You with me? All right. So as we close the book of Jonah, we are going to look at this beautiful, wonderful, this girl is too small and my brain is too small to articulate all of what's here, but we'll leave it to the Spirit to do all the heavy lifting today. Remember that we decided that the primary thing that is the primary theme in the book of Jonah is in the literary structure. We talked about making a club sandwich, right? So at the top, the bread is Yahweh's saving mercy for Jonah. At the bottom is Yahweh's saving mercy for Nineveh. That's the bread. Then, you know, like the cheese, for those of us that eat cheese, there's Jonah's unexplained disobedience at the top. And then when you get to chapter 4, there's Jonah's disobedience explained, which we're going to try to do. Then if you get to whatever real turkey we're using or mystery meat that we're using, there's Yahweh saves the sailors, and then Yahweh saves Nineveh in chapter 3. But right in the middle, friends, and the middle has just got to be the best garden tomato you have ever sliced to put in a sandwich, yes? In the middle is the theme, the focus of what Jesus is doing here. And what is in the center? God saving Jonah. All right? Jonah was a man on a stormy sea, as we've already learned, just like Jesus was. Jonah was a man sleeping in a boat, as we've already learned, just like Jesus was. And Jesus attaches himself in the book of Matthew. And so we're going to go back over our scripture reading. So here we go. Some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him. Who were they talking to? Jesus himself. Teacher, we wish to see a sign. Really? Something bigger than yourself. So I want you to see this wonderful tension. It's in the book of Jonah and it's right here in the gospel. This wonderful tension between something way bigger than yourself, and over here we've got the obvious. Do you think when you spent any time with Jesus that there was anything that was, you know, a little cloudy, a little fuzzy, a little obscure? If there ever was a man who lived where it was what you see is what you get, it was Jesus. And yet they're asking for what again, friends? A sign. But he, Jesus, answered and said unto them, an evil, don't miss it, an evil, an adulterous generation seeks a sign, and a sign will what? Not be given to it except the sign of Jonah the prophet. So imagine, after everything we've learned about our prodigal prophet, our reluctant, disobedient, going down prophet, he's the one that Jesus attaches himself to for a twofold reason. Here's the first that I can see. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights where? In the heart of the earth. So this is going to be the foundation for how we're going to try to finish this book that ends on a cliffhanger. Are you ready? Here we go. So you know that Mr. Jonah, finally, after he got vomited up by the great fish, Mr. Hot Mess, makes his way, we saw the map, to Nineveh, the capital of what nation, friends? Assyria. He makes his way into this city that takes how many days to get across it? It's so big. 3 days, he journeys 1 day into the sort of center of the city, and he sets up shop to preaching. And what was it that he was telling them? 40 days and Nineveh shall be what? overthrown. So he had a lot of motives for not wanting to do it. Mostly they were nationalistic motives. These people were the worst people that he could possibly think of, and the idea that God wanted to preach repentance to them was repugnant to him, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. I'm sure he was a little nervous, a little afraid about what might happen to him in the most violent nation on the face of the earth when he started talking about judgment coming their way. But you know what happened, friends, because we were together last weekend. What did they do? They repented. They at least relented. They might have repented. From who to who? From the king or the governor? You guys are really sleepy today. Don't be doing that to me. All the way down to where? Now, below the servants. The Bible actually mentions the animals. Everybody was wearing sackcloth. Everybody was fasting. So I'm here to tell you, friends, aren't you in the middle of sharing God's word with your community right now? If the entire, is this a borough, Warminster? Township. If the entire township of Warminster were to throw up their hands and go, we're ready. We're ready for the Bible. We're ready for God. We're ready for Bucks. We're ready. What kind of, you know, like emotions would you be having, my friends? Yay! We've got one, yay! But here's our man. Jonah was very deeply grieved, and he was confounded. One artist puts it like this. Mr. Hot Mess is now having a meltdown. Yes? What's up with that? So we're going to find out. Jonah is confronted with this idea, this beautiful, radical, amazing idea. And you start to see the title push of why Jesus associates himself with this man. God's mercy is what, friends? Relentless. Relentless. Now, watch. Here we go. Jonah chapter 4. Back to verse 1 and through verse 2. Now, I'm going to read the whole thing from the message. I know I don't usually do that, but I'm going to do it today. We're going to have like a narrative feel about it. I want you to feel the emotions, the passion. If you're looking at your tablet or your phone and you have the version that you love, that's perfectly fine. Just add the thoughts to what we're going to do. Jonah was what, friends? He was furious. He lost his temper. And then he did something crazy. What did he do? He yelled at God. Now, I'm going to tell you that that's not always a crazy thing to do, because authentic emotion is something God wants to experience with you. You might have to repent when it's over, but it's better not to try to lie to God. Don't we agree? All right, so he yelled at God, God, I knew it! When I was back home, I knew this was going to happen. Now, what did we decide when we started the book of Jonah? Was he like a poor, dusty prophet wearing clothes from a secondhand store? No. Where was he? Who was he ministering to and working with? And where were his digs located? He was attached to the palace, my friends. To the palace. He had a nice 401k, an excellent reputation. I knew this was going to happen. That's why I ran off to Tarshish. I knew you were sheer grace and mercy, not easily angered, rich in love, and ready at the drop of a hat to turn your plans of punishment into a what? Woohoo! Can we say amen? So watch his emotions, friends. Watch his articulations. So God, if you won't do what? This is what Jonah wanted. If you won't kill them, what is the next best thing? I'm better off dead. Now, friends, I want you to take this out of that story that you've known since you were a child, if you were raised in Sabbath school or Sunday school. Why does he feel like this? Because I want this story to be contemporary for you. What good is it if it isn't contemporary for you? Why does he feel this way? What is the deep taproot of his emotional outburst here? No wrong answer to the question. Tell me what you're thinking. Right through that mask, say it loud. Okay, so he's got a personal problem with the Assyrians. Okay, Nineveh was the capital of Assyria. Okay, remember in part one of this story, we learned that the Assyrians were incredibly violent people. They were an enemy of who? Israel. They were really an enemy of the whole world. Anybody who wasn't with them was really against them as far as they were concerned. But for Jonah's purposes, they were an enemy of Israel. Okay, so stay with me. His emotions, his passion, his frustration, it was rooted in his nationalism. Yes? You with me? You coming with me? You don't have to fully agree with me to come with me, but let's contemplate the idea. Rooted in his nationalism, God is crossing over the barriers of his rank, of his profession. A prophet had never been called to preach to the Gentile world. But mostly, friends, God is crossing over his understanding of who's who with God. In his mind, who's who with God? Israel. Period. Yes? So I want you to let it in. In these tumultuous times that we live in, I want you to wrestle with the idea that in the craziest time you've ever seen in the United States of America, God is going to do things that are unexpected to you. Now, while God takes no pleasure in the difficulties that are coming on the whole world because of COVID-19, the Lord doesn't think like we do. For him, it's a tragedy, but it's also an opportunity. And you, my friends, need to embrace that if you want to be his kids in 2021. You with me? All right. So God says to him, What do you have to be angry about? What's your beef? And the reason God asks him the question is why? Yes, he wants him to root out the answer. He wants him to root out the answer. So let's try to wrap our minds around the great big themes that are here. For as Jonah was three days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, true story or not? Yes. Remember, when God asks you to believe something that is practically impossible, that's a good thing. So the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Jesus was swallowed by this yawning mouth, yes? And this man was swallowed by a different yawning mouth. This is Jonah. And Jesus attaches himself to this story as fact, this impossible story as fact. Because the grave was going to spit him back onto the shore. Yes? Yes. But Jonah just left. God confronts him. He asks him a question. Why are you angry? Did Jonah answer the question? He didn't. He just left. He went out of the city to the east and sat down in a what? Sulk. He put together a makeshift shelter of leafy branches and sat there in the shade to see what would happen to the city. Now, he should have already known what was going to happen to the city, yes? Because the city did what? So he's still hoping, beyond hope, that God can't be a God like this. Are you with me, friends? We must open our hearts, our minds, the avenues into our souls in these crazy times that we live in, because God is about to pour himself onto the planet in ways that we have never seen. And if we claim that we know That doesn't mean we can't have security and comfort in all the beautiful things we've learned up until now. But friends, we have got to be open, open-hearted, open-minded. Jonah is so locked up right here. He's still sitting waiting for what he's absolutely sure should happen to happen. He can't move with God in real time. Are you with me? He's stuck in the history that he has projected onto the future. Now watch how merciful God is. Because friends, have you ever been that stubborn? Oh yeah, totally. My family name is Bartini. Stubborn is my middle name. Impatient is my middle name. God arranged for a broadleaf tree to spring it up. Now what had Jonah done? Before this happens, it says he built himself a what? A lean-to. Anybody ever built a lean-to in the woods? He built himself a little lean-to. He wove it together with whatever provisions he had. And they, what's the topography, friends? Okay, it's like desert with a little oasis type things here and there. God arranged for a broad-leafed tree. And you get the idea that there weren't many broad-leafed trees in this topography. He arranged for a broad-leaf tree to spring up. How fast does something spring up? Boom! That must have been cool to watch. You know, you've watched like a little shoot spring up, but have you ever watched a whole tree spring up? It grew over Jonah to cool him off and get him out of his angry sulk. Jonah was pleased. And he enjoyed the shade. Life was looking up. So let's not pick on Jonah so much. Let's give God all the credit here. So friends, when you're in an angry sulk and you're just stuck and stubborn, how's the Lord functioning toward you? He's kind, always kind. So another artist put it this way. Doesn't he look content? See, but God isn't finished yet, because remember, what is the whole point of this book? For the same mercy, the same warning that had just saved this entire city is supposed to do what? Save him. Isn't that good news, friends? That is super good news. But, sometimes but is a really good word in the Bible. Not so much here. But then God sent a what? A worm. I want you to look at the language here, because this whole book is just so beautifully ancient, so beautifully contemporary. There's such amazing literary artistry here. Watch. God sent a worm. By the dawn of the next day, the worm had... Now, before we go on, I want you to remember, there's a lot of trajectories that we talked about in this book. Jonah's heading in one particular direction. Where's he headed? Down. And we talked about the difference between going down for the count and going low with God, right? And so he's just been headed down. And God keeps chasing him into the low places. And here's the last of it. Because what does the worm do? The worm bores is the word. Think of the word in your head. The worm bores into the shade tree, and it withered away. God's taking away the last of what will not serve him ultimately. The sun came up, and then, remember, disruptive grace, friends, disruptive grace. And then God sent a, not just hot, but blistering wind from the east. So it wasn't just you that you could feel the temperature, but whatever was in the atmosphere when this wind was blowing around, it was hitting you on the skin. This was a serious wind. It says the sun beat down on Jonah's head and he started to what? To faint. That's how hot it was. And then he keeps praying that same prayer, friends. He's been praying it since he left his house. Way back at the beginning of the story, what's the prayer? I can't live. I can't live here. I can't live in a world where God forgives like this. And I can't observe that forgiveness and render it effective for myself. Do you see how powerful this is? How confrontational it is? He doesn't want to live in God's reality. And friends, we must guard ourselves. Because if the doors of the church fling open over the next few weeks and over the next few months and into 2021, the dear, sweet, wonderful folks who come in the back door are going to be just like me when I came in the back door. I was 17 years old when I embrace this body of biblical truth, and I became a Seventh-day Adventist, and I drove every single person in the New Haven, Connecticut congregation right outside their minds because I was uncouth. I wasn't trained in church behavior. I'm still not trained in church behavior, in case you haven't noticed. But do you understand what I'm saying? I didn't dress right. I didn't act right. I didn't eat the right things. I was a hot mess. And I just showed up in the back door of your church and went, woohoo! Praise the Lord! That's a good thing, friends. That's a good thing. We have got to be willing for God to upset us. Right next door in the pew, right next door in the workplace, right next door in the neighborhood, the community, and friends, I'm just going to say, right next door in the country. We have a lot of differing viewpoints here, but we do not have to agree to be effective for Christ in the times that we're living in. Do you hear me? And we can demonstrate that we serve Christ when the American experiment becomes much greater than the American experiment, when it comes the kingdom experiment, and it functions well. Are you with me? So what does Jonah want? He wants to check out. He's like, I'm not up for it. I'm not into it. No, thank you. So the poor guy is just sitting under his withered tree, sulking. So let's take stock, friends. Anybody know what this is? Football. Michigan. I wandered in there one time when I was in Michigan completely by accident. I was just taking a walk, staying with some new friends that I met. And, you know, I'm all about whatever college campuses are doing. And so I was enjoying the green space, and I just sort of, you know, walked in the building. I literally walked into this place like behind one of the maintenance guys, totally unaware of where I was. And wow. And it was empty when I went in, but it was the biggest architectural thing outside of Europe that I'd ever seen. How many people can you seat? How many people are you looking at? About 107,600. 107,600 people. So more than twice that many have died in your nation since the spring from COVID-19. That's got to move us, friends. That's got to be something so much larger than a political discussion. Because we belong to Christ. She's from the same state. What's the big deal about this girl right here? They tried to kidnap her. Michigan. The plot was to hit more than one state house at the same time. There's about 8 to 12 people involved. And to kidnap the leaders for whatever, I don't know what it is they've decided that they were going to want for their release. I haven't read deeply enough to know yet. Friends, that's political terrorism. That doesn't happen in America, or at least we didn't think it did. The reason I bring these things up is just to make us aware. Jonah was confronted with ideas that were so outside his comfort zone. And now we're confronted with them all the time. So God says to him, "What right do you have to get angry?" And in the immediate context, what's he angry about? The shade tree. You brought it up, you gave it to me, and then it died. And Jonah says, out of his authenticity, plenty of right. It's made me angry enough to die. That seems to be the theme. God said, "What's this? How is it that you can change your feelings from pleasure to anger overnight about a mere what? You'll delve into your emotions, you'll make changes, you'll make adjustments about a mere shade tree, and you did nothing to bring that tree into existence. You didn't plant it, you didn't water it, it grew up in one night and it died the next night. So how is it that you can be so invested?" Why was he so invested, friends? Because it served who? It served him. And this is one of the great themes here. Is this what we do in church? Is this why we do church? Is this why we do God? For ourselves. And of course we're blessed, and we're glad to be blessed. I'm not going to tell you I'm not glad to be blessed. But here's the point. God says, so why? Can't I likewise change what I feel? What I feel about Nineveh from what? From anger to pleasure. This big city of more than how many people? Michigan Stadium on a crowded afternoon. Big city of more than 120,000 childlike people who don't yet know right from wrong. To say nothing of all the what? The innocent animals. God's like, look, you care about the tree, but I care about all life. And I care about it for the right reason. And my motivations are much higher than yours. And guess what, friends? The book ends right there. The book ends right there. Big cliffhanger. No resolution. No, you know, like 42-minute turn it around into something good like we're used to on television, right? So here's my hope. My hope is that the only person who could have told the story with any authenticity whenever it got written down was who? Was Jonah himself. So I'm just hoping that my brother got his head screwed on straight. But isn't it appropriate, friends, because do I know what's coming between now and Christmas? I don't know. I know what the epidemiologists are saying. That this is going to be one of the worst winters I've ever known since I've been alive. And maybe it won't be true, but God's got it. He's got it. So I want to take you back to the New Testament as we close, because we talked about how Jesus joined his life to Jonah's. Watch. As crowds were gathering, Luke says, around Jesus, he said, "You people of today are," where's that word again? "Evil. You keep looking for a sign from God." Remember in Matthew, they were like, "Show us a sign." It's so funny how in their culture, something supernatural was supposed to be like the mainstream, the normal. And in our culture, if you believe in something supernatural, they think you're backward. But what? Oh, you keep looking for a sign from God. But what happened to who? Jonah is the only sign you will be given. Now, friends, the simplified version of what that means is just what we talked about a few moments ago. 3 days, 3 nights, everybody take a look. And that is important, but I don't believe it's as important as what's written here. Just as Jonah was assigned to who? The people of Nineveh. The Son of Man will be assigned to the people of today. See, I believe that Jonah, the 3 days, 3 nights context, was written for historical need. You're going to look back at the cross. You're going to see the connection. You're going to see that I asked you to believe in something impossible. A man got swallowed by a great fish. Nothing. A man went into the grave and saved the entire human race and came out alive. Now that's something. Now watch as Jesus goes on in the book of Luke. When judgment comes, the queen of the south, that's the queen of Sheba who came to visit Solomon, the queen of the south will stand there with you and condemn you. She traveled a long way to hear Solomon's wisdom, and yet here is something far greater than Solomon. The people of Nineveh will also stand there with you and condemn you. They turned to God when Jonah preached, and yet here, and he's speaking of who? Himself. Here is something far greater than what? Jonah. What was their objection to Jesus, friends? The establishment of the day. What was their objection? They had a lot of them, don't get me wrong. But what were the big ones? Okay, he redefined the law in ways that made them really, really uncomfortable. Say that again. Yes, here it is, friends. It was the people that he was willing to come alongside. Wasn't that Jonah's problem? The people that God was willing to come alongside. Jonah had a real problem with that. Jesus' generation, the establishment of the day, had a real problem with that. Because their nationalism, their pride. Now here I am, I'm going to step on your toes. Are you ready? Their denominationalism separated him, Jonah, separated the scribes, the Pharisees, from the very people that God wanted to save. This is what Jesus is talking about when he's talking about the sign of Jonah. Don't make the same mistake. Don't leave the book undone on some kind of a cliffhanger. Disruptive grace, right? God comes along and reshifts our pieces, reorders the books on our shelves, reorders the shards in our soul to make us more like him every single day. So as we close this morning, I want to encourage you to believe in the impossible. The very thing that our culture says makes you moronic or uneducated or backward, forget it. Hosea says this, I want to free them from the power of the grave. This is the point. Salvation that leads to eternal life. I want to reclaim them from death, not just physical death, but what? Spiritual death. Death, I want to be a plague to you. Grave, I want to destroy you. I won't even think of changing my mind. This is God's purpose. He loved the Ninevites, friends, and he loves every man, woman, and child from here to wherever you can reach if you walk outside this door. And he's got plans in the craziest of times to make his salvation accessible to them for the saving of their souls. And he wants to use us to do it. So when you're tossing on the sea and you have to throw the stuff overboard, remember that God's storms, they get our attention. They humble us. They realign our life, which when we leave Jonah at the end of the book, he doesn't seem quite yet to agree to. But the realigning aligns our life to what? To God's plans. And so, friends, let's never again be pointing the finger at our man Jonah. I am Jonah. We are Jonah. Lots for God to do yet. Lots for him to build on, and some of that building will require tearing down. Don't be afraid of it. Don't resist it. Don't spend your time, waste your time arguing with the God who loves you more than his own life. And open your doors to whomever will come in and take that camera wherever it will go for the saving of those who Jesus died for. Are you in? All right, we are going to try this again. And if something goes wrong, I'm just going to pray. I'm not going to panic. How's that? All right, let me get where I need to go. And then we are going to sing together. Somebody asked me if that was my intention last time, which it is. So if God asks you, are you willing to do something that you've never, ever heard of, thought of along your spiritual journey before? What will your reply be? How about, yes, I will? I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail you now. He won't fail you now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. And yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will. And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Father, may this be our answer. Yes, I will. Yes, I will go where you've never called me before. Yes, I will go in places that might get me in trouble with the people I go to church with because they might say, you know, you shouldn't be socializing over there. And I don't mean by safety. I mean by economic status, by habits, by behavior. Those Assyrians, Lord, they had some very strange behaviors. But you said that they didn't know. You said they were children. You said they didn't know their right hand from their left. They didn't know right from wrong. And Lord, our culture has been eking you out and pounding you out and erasing you out for decades. And it might take a lot of courage for someone to say, hey, I want to learn about God. I want to know something about Jesus. And Lord, in that knowing, it won't be necessary on any day of the week for them to redact their Bibles of the supernatural. Because you are the Creator God. And you love to confound. I think you find it just a little humorous that we should have any doubt that a big fish swallowed a small man. Jonah was so unwilling, so ignorant. And Jesus was so willing and so powerful and so loving. And so we just ask that this story will bear fruit in our life for many days and months to come. And that we will become who you want us to be and we will go where you want us to go. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
The closing song will be, How Great is Our God?
Above all names, you are worthy. sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, sing how great is our God.
Happy Sabbath.
Your presence in here.
Waiting for the king.